Okay, greetings everyone, and thank you for joining us today. We've got an exciting session ahead of us. For those who might be joining us for the first time, we run these sessions several times a year. They started out as being events that we ran with our international panel on accountancy education, really to have give them an opportunity to engage with experts in different topics of strategic importance to the panel. As some of you will know, earlier this year, we started to open it up to the broader community of IFAC volunteers. So really excited to have many of you on the call today. So our first speaker today is Professor Stephen Coetzee. Stephen is a professor of accounting at the University of Pretoria in South Africa. And he has a teaching philosophy that is deeply rooted in socio-constructivism. He champions team teaching and collaborative learning, judiciously integrated with technology to foster critical thinking, precise communication, and lifelong learning among his students. His current research aligns with his teaching approach, focusing on team teaching, collaborative assessment, and, very relevant to today, the utilization of artificial intelligence in educational settings. Stephen has published widely, including publications in the British Journal of Education Technology and Assessment and Evaluation in Higher Education. He has also received numerous teaching awards, including South Africa's National Excellence in Teaching and Learning Award. But today, Stephen is here to tell us about work that he's been doing with artificial intelligence, and he's created an amazing AI tutor that is already being used by students in South Africa. Stephen, over to you. We're excited to hear from you.
Thanks, Bruce. It's really great to be with all of you today. When I got the invite list and I saw all the attendees, it made me rather nervous for a moment. So I think I'm going to upfront put a disclaimer out. And I was also interested in the title, the expert series. I don't think I'm going to try and give myself out as an expert on AI. I don't work for OpenAI, and this stuff is changing so quickly. I'm not sure anybody is an expert. It's changing so fast. But what I am is a teacher that I think, like most of you that might be involved in education, that when ChatGPT hit the world, it did sort of shake some foundations. So that's really where I'm coming from today, is just my experience as a teacher with AI over the last 11 months. The challenges we've experienced and just what I've learned about it and how it works, and hopefully overcome some of the fears with it. So that's sort of the angle I'm coming from today, hopefully relatable to many of you. And then Sri, I know, is going from more from the business point of view later on, and the skills that the students are going to need in practice, where I'm really coming from the classroom side of things and the education side of things in this presentation. The first question I want to put to everybody on the call, and you can just ponder it for yourself for a moment or two, what was your first response to ChatGPT when it came out? Maybe a month after it came out? How did you feel about it? What was your view on it? I think the picture that you see on the slide sort of describes many of our emotions. It's definitely mine. There was all sorts of panic, I think, in a lot of classrooms across the world about the effect that this is going to have. There was panic, I think, perhaps with people in practice thinking that this will replace their jobs. So I don't know, reflect for a moment on yourself. Where were you in January and February, December, perhaps last year when news of this all broke? And perhaps where are you now? I think a lot of this has calmed down since. So I tried to reflect. Now, when Bruce invited me to do this, where was I emotionally in my thoughts in December, January, February? Cheating came up a lot. The students cheating on assessments, using it as a great tool to create essays. And that was a narrative that I saw a lot on social media. And still to today, people are worried about the cheating. A lot of people were worried about being replaced in their jobs, whether you're an academic. I mean, why would the students need me if they can just ask ChatGPT? Doing work out in practice. I mean, we've all seen how well it does on the professional exams, whether they're law, accounting, medical. Where are we? A lot of uncertainty, I think, came from all of that. I'm not sure if there's any others that you're feeling. If you want to share them in the chat, you're more than welcome. So with those emotions, something else that came up to us was almost a lack of control. I'm responsible together with two colleagues for about 500 intermediate accounting students. And we had no influence on what they were doing with ChatGPT. Were they using it or other AI resources that Microsoft's built into their web browsers and things? We just didn't know. We didn't know. I mean, you could ask them, but they would probably have denied it in case you are insinuating they're cheating. So it's just that feeling of it was out of my control. It was not something in my sphere of influence for my students. So that was an emotion that really over time started driving what we were going to do and our response to AI in the classroom here in Pretoria. To get the session kicked off, though, I think I need to... One of the most powerful things I learned early on was I saw a tweet stream, or now the X, with Elon Musk, a South African, always good people. But with on X, I saw a Twitter feed, a stream, whatever you call them now, on X, tweets, X's, I'm not sure, that just sort of explained how these large language models work. And once I'd seen this, a few lights sort of went on. So to start the presentation, I just want to share with you a little bit. And I'm really not technically inclined. You may know far more than I do about these things. But maybe for one or two people that are still feeling uncertain, this just gives you a way of thinking about this rather than having this idea of this Terminator robot that's going to take over the world. Because it's really not that far and advanced at all when it comes down to the basics of it. So I've got the link there if you want to go at some stage and have a look at the feed that this guy did on Twitter. That we must take all credit for this, and he really helped me to understand it. But how he explained how these large language models work is you'd put a phrase, for example, into it and say an apple a day. And then it responds to you, as you can see there, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. And everybody thinks this is this genius. It's this thing's thinking. And that's not really true. A language model is actually predicting what's the most likely next word in its response. So I want to explain that now with the example of we had this whole issue initially, and it is clearing up a little bit as these things get access to the internet. But there was the issue of fake references that ChatGPT would be generating. So it would sound like this realistic paper that somebody must have written, but it was actually absolute rubbish. There was no such paper. But let's just have a look at the mechanics of how ChatGPT was coming up with those things. So you could put a prompt into ChatGPT that would say, what is the most cited economics paper of all time? Then its response, going on the probability of what is the next most likely word. So you've asked it the most cited. So it starts its response with the most cited economic paper of all time is. So that's more a case of a language ability of it predicting which words it needs to use. And then it would now construct the reference for you. So again, this is in the early days of GPT. This was based on GPT 3.5 before GPT had access to the internet and to be able to search Bing, et cetera, which has now made it more powerful. But just to explain the mechanics. So you'd put that in, it would begin its response like that. Then I took its response. Well, this person on X took the response, and he went and then tried to see how the GPT was creating that response. So the first thing you need for a paper is a title. So there was a research paper that came out in 2019 that was giving you all these keywords and things that have come up in the economics literature over the last century. And you can sort of see them in Wordles on the screen for yourself. You can pick out the words economic theory, model growth, etc. So how ChatGPT would look at this is it'd be looking now for a title. So what's the most likely words from those in the economics literature to include in a title? So it started off with a theory of economic. It used those words, pulling them through as the most likely words that it should give you. And then it added on in the instance when we put it through, the man and X put it through as history, a theory of economic history. So that was the title that it came up with. Completely make believe the paper doesn't exist. Then after filling out the title field, what does it do next? It's trying to think of the next most likely word in the response. So it knows you need a title for a paper. The next thing you're looking for is an author for the paper. So it looked in its database of language. and it found the author Douglas North. And he's the most prolific author of research in economic history. There's a quote there from Wikipedia, and you'll see there was an American economist known for his work in economic history. So his name would have been associated a lot with those words, economic history. So ChatGPT is looking on the probabilities of things. So if a paper has the word economic history in the heading, it's trying to match an author to that heading of economic history, Douglas North. And if you look on Douglas's Google Scholar profile, I mean, see the citations are, I'm not sure I'll achieve those in 100 lifetimes, never mind in one. It's out of this world. But it's just showing you again, his name being associated with the words economic history, working on probabilities. So then it makes up this paper, it makes up that author. Then ChatGPT is going to say the probabilities is he's not a single author, there'll be another author. It then pulled in this other name, and that person is Douglas North's most common co-author. So of all the authorship teams he's been involved in, those are the two that that often write together. Then it needs a journal. It needs to give you a journal for this reference. It knows what a reference looks like. We've got a title. We've got authors. It needs a journal. So it went and had a look at where it got that Journal of Economic History from is Douglas North's most cited co-authored paper comes out of the Journal of Economic History. So there you can see again, working on probabilities. It knows it's looking for a co-authored paper, probabilities, which journal is it most likely to have been in the Journal of Economic History. And another way, if it's working with probabilities, is this Douglas North was also the editor of that journal for several years. So his name would have been associated with a lot of editorial things on there. So if you're working on probabilities again, it just seems to hit home for the GPT, the language model. So the year then it gave was 1969. There's a book that was published in 1969 called A Theory of Economic History. So it's attached that as the year for this paper. So it came up with the reference, A Theory of Economic History, written by Douglas. It's all Journal of Economic History, 1969. But that doesn't exist. There's a book by another author, but there's no research paper. So that just, when I saw this, it helped me to understand a little bit. This thing's not really thinking. It's not like the human brain. It's not competing with us in that. It's got a lot of language available to it, a lot of text available to it. And the way it's been programmed with probability of the next word in the sentence, it's able to generate quite realistic things, but it's not really thinking in that sense of it. So now that it's got access to the internet and it's able to do searches on search engines and things, it is getting better references. I tried this morning just for interest's sake to put this in again, and I got an article given back to me, and I looked at the citations. There's no ways that is the most cited economics paper of all time. So again, it's working on what it's got available and working on probabilities of what the wording is that you're looking for. And I think what's key in this AI, everybody's fixated on the AI, but the AI is based on large language models. This thing is about language. It's an expert at language. And that's why it can write essays and things that are so good, because it understands grammar rules. It can predict what would be the most likely next word in a sentence to construct sentences and things to you. But it's not really that the Terminator image, those of us that grew up in the 80s will remember the Terminator movies. It's not this robot that's walking around and thinking, etc. Not yet, at least. I'm sure we'll get there in time, but not yet. So I hope that just sort of helped you to start understanding how the thing works. It's getting better, definitely, at what it's doing. I mean, GPT 4.5 Turbo was released on Monday by OpenAI, and Elon Musk is going to be releasing to the public very soon his version of a large language model coming through the X platform. So these things are developing, they are getting, and I don't want to use the word cleverer because everybody uses that. They're getting more advanced, but I wouldn't say cleverer because cleverer implies thinking, and it's not really thinking. So now that brings me into a session today on accounting education and AI and how we responded to it. So our initial fear with the whole thing initially was our students were out of our zone of influence. And they were just perhaps going to ChatGPT. I can perhaps, at the risk of making you all a little bit drunk, go back to the slide. There's one of my students sitting this evening at home in the dorm, wherever he's studying. He's asking ChatGPT questions. I don't know how well he's prompting ChatGPT. So what I've also learned over the last 10 months is prompting is very important. The way you ask it a question. And our students are not really great at asking ChatGPT questions. We've seen that in the own application we built, and I'll chat about it later on. And even with Googling, I look at my own, I've got twin boys that are sort of just pre-teens now. And without sounding arrogant, I can out-Google them. And the reason I can do that is I can type Google and I can more quickly look at those results and sort of sift through and see, no, wait, that search term is not getting me results that make sense. And I can adjust my search term and filter these things a lot quicker. And the problem is, to be able to do that, you need to have a level of knowledge already inside you, your own cognitive framework for all of this. So where we are with 30, 40 years life knowledge and experience, you're able to look at Google results and think, oh, this isn't quite right, let me tweak it. The kids today don't have that experience and knowledge yet. They're still learning. So it's harder for them to go back and to redo searches, etc. So yes, everybody raves about the younger kids being great on whizzes, on Instagram and all those things, which is fabulous. But they don't have that pre-existing knowledge in their heads yet to be filtering things and to be able to search like the older of us are able to search. So prompting is very important. And I don't, from what we've seen, our students are not great at prompting. And it's really just like with Google, rubbish in, rubbish out. And ChatGPT, in my opinion, is even more sensitive to that. The better you develop the prompt, the better the output's going to be, because it's working on this whole probability. So if you just type something short into ChatGPT, you're not giving it a whole lot to work with to come up with a prediction of the text you're expecting in return. So there's this term, and I know she will speak about it later on as well, prompt engineering. And designing those prompts is something we've actually got to look at with our children, our students, and children as well at school. And in that, there's a challenge for those of us that are teachers, because we'll be able to teach our students, perhaps, or should teach them, how to prompt for their discipline. So we have accounting students. I'm actually involved in the health professions as well, where they replicating what we're doing in accounting education. So they're involved with the medical students. So they will be taught how to prompt to get information for their profession as an accountant, as a medical doctor. What they have no idea about is education. They don't know what is the best ways and theories about learning that can influence their learning and make it absolutely maximal for themselves. So they'll use ChatGPT, but they're not going to know to tell ChatGPT to use a growth mindset, for example, in the prompt. That's not something that comes up to them. They're not taught teachers. And that's where we need to start playing a role in their learning and taking control of these things. So to represent that visually, there's my student sitting alone, there's ChatGPT. Our idea on our course early in the year was we wanted to insert ourselves somehow between the student and between ChatGPT. And we have now had previous experience of working with applications. And many years ago, you may remember the messenger bots that Facebook was playing around with in about 2018. So we had that sort of experience. And then we sat back on our course and we thought, okay, great. How can we do this? And OpenAI has got APIs. And APIs, in a way, you can talk to that language model from your own application and you don't need to use their commercial ChatGPT. So we thought, okay, we could create an application, put it between ourselves and the students, that we can then help the student. The student would put in a prompt, we'll add to that prompt, send it through to the large language model, and hopefully fetch a better quality reply for the student. So starting to have an influence on their education and being able to prompt in ways that the student wouldn't necessarily think to prompt because they don't know the educational and the learning theories. So to give you an example to anchor everything I've been speaking in now, we ask the language model something like our students, and this is really what they do. I'm an accounting lecturer, so excuse the bias towards accounting. But our students wouldn't type something like even bothering to say, explain a change in accounting policy or explain a change in accounting policy. I'm an intermediate student. I'm a new student to accounting. Explain it in the context of inventories. They don't give the model all that. They'll just rock up on their phones tonight or on their computers and they'll start change in accounting policy, expecting miracles to work on the other side. So if you type that into ChatGPT, it gives you quite a good reply. It's quite a generic reply. You'll see in the middle of your screen there, it refers to the FASB, it refers to the ISB. So it doesn't really tailor it to me. It'll give me this reply, whether I am in practice for 20 years, whether I'm brand new to the change in accounting policy standards and accounting for changes in accounting policies. So it is helpful, but I mean, it looks pretty much like a bad textbook, quite frankly. But it is giving information. So what we've tried to do is we've taken that same question now. So with our application, we take the change in accounting policy and then I add onto it. When the students registered for our application, we asked them some questions like, what country are you in? What learning speed do you like? What is your current depth of knowledge on the topic, etc.? And then we feed all of that context with their question. And then we also attach to it learning theories and things that we think are important, like encourage a growth mindset, ask the student to think about it, ask a question perhaps at the end that they can then think about it and start scaffolding their learning a little bit. So you're giving ChatGPT more clarity on the role it has to play. So just a very simple example, I asked our application now with all that tagged on change in accounting policy, which I mean, we've now seen as a very, very generic way of asking it. But because the application had now told ChatGPT, the language model in the background, I'm from South Africa, it knows IFRS, it doesn't even mention US GAAP, it goes straight to IS8 because it now is working in a narrower concept. And it just constructs a more relevant answer for that student. So yeah, prompting is hugely important in the quality of the response you're going to be getting from it. Then what we've tried to do now to develop it over time. Now, I'm really not trying to promote the application. I'm trying to give you ideas and just give you things to think about in your own classroom, what you can use ChatGPT for in teaching and learning, etc. So what we've done is there's a little button in the application now, because we know our students love YouTube videos to learn from. They go and sit and watch them at double speed. It saves them time and they can learn double in the same time kind of thing as their view of the world. So what we've done with it is we've now used ChatGPT and we'll say, right, if the student clicks that button, this is what the student asked. This is what you responded. Develop the optimal search term for YouTube. So then ChatGPT knows what the optimal way is to structure a search term, and it'll structure a beautiful search term for you. Then we collect that, we send it through to YouTube, and it returns the most relevant videos based on that search term. That'll help the student in understanding whatever they're discussing with a large language model. So it's again using the AI to support you in what you're doing, definitely not replacing you. Then something else we've seen is the students in their chats initially earlier in the year before this was added in, and ChatGPT also gives you this option now, but I'll explain our reasoning behind it. When we analyze the chats that the students were having, they sort of just stop and you sort of feel as a teacher, you know what, just ask one more question and then I think you're going to understand it a lot more. You get a little anxious hoping that they do that. So what we then thought about is, let's ask the large language model that works on probabilities, it's the thing it does well, to suggest what would be the best follow-up question for the student to ask at this stage. So then we can push that through to the student. So again, we're trying to take control of something we originally had no control over to help our students learn optimally in the way we want to learn and we believe learning should be. And again, on this pattern of the student not going that one step further, we added a deep dive where we asked ChatGPT then, based on that, if the student says deep dive, take them that bit further. Engage them in active learning. Ask them something and let's see if they can now perhaps apply to their knowledge that you've just shared with them. So that whole bit on IS8 was very much content of IS8. Can they apply that? Can they transfer that knowledge? And then it'll come up now in the deep dive option, and it just takes it that further to Silverstone Industries, for example, just to see if they can do that. And another part of the whole learning thing is students shouldn't just be absorbing the knowledge it gives to you. I mean, you're trying to be active in your learning. You're trying to absorb that knowledge, make it your own, and then see if you can use it. So then again, a student on ChatGPT will go in and say, give me a quiz. Okay, fabulous. ChatGPT will give you a quiz. But I mean, there is a whole volume of literature and theory out there about designing optimal multiple choice questions and quiz questions to really optimize the learning, to have quality distractors, et cetera, that you can really distinguish between knowing and not knowing. So we could then, in the prompt on this, type all of that sort of educational stuff into it, tell ChatGPT to remember these good qualities of MCQ questions and apply them in creating a question for the student to test themselves. And then we've also got the Vignette option, which is just a little bit more of an advanced, I guess, MCQ, where it's a bit more of a scenario, not so much into the basic details of it. But again, we've got the learning theories in the background of what makes a good Vignette, and we send that through to ChatGPT before pulling the response through to the student. So if you go back to that picture I shared where we're inserting ourselves and we're taking control back from the language model, and we're trying to pull out the best learning experience we can now for the students from it. And on this screen, I'm just showing you the Vignette now a bit more broadly. The student would choose option D, and then the language model would then again respond and say, you've got it right, or you don't have it right. If you don't have it right, think about this, etc. And the whole time, those options to go deeper and the student can type a follow-up message are all there just to advance that learning experience for them. Now, as I said earlier on when I was trying to help understand how these things are working, it's working on probabilities. It's not thinking. So it does make mistakes sometimes. So this one example came up when I was developing these slides. And it thought that something is a change in accounting policy that's actually a change in estimate. So it did make a mistake. Now, I have that background knowledge that I could challenge it and say, wait, but this doesn't look right. A student might not have that. So it does make mistakes. And that's where I suppose it may be a slightly obsessive compulsive from my side. I don't know. But it makes me nervous to think that my students might be sitting tonight with ChatGPT asking it something, it's giving them a response, and they are blindly relying on it. And there's no way I know that, so I sleep peacefully because I don't know it. But the poor student now is going to have the wrong information given to him. So we thought some long and hard about how we can influence that. So what we did is now, because we can see these conversations, we built in the facility that I can actually interject in the conversation. So if I see that something's going off the rails, that I can also type a message in and I can see what the student's done. I can see the answer's not right. I can see the student's going on the wrong track here. I can interject. So we put that on as well for our students. That became very labor intensive because, as I said earlier on, I've got 500 students between the three of us. So even if we split it up equally, it's still hundreds of students each that we're trying to monitor all their conversations. Wasn't really practical. So something that is applicable, whether you're using this AE bot, whether you're using ChatGPT, we need to be teaching our students that you can't take everything for gospel. You've got to be looking at these things with a critical mindset. Does that really make sense? Does it align with what you've read in your textbook or heard from your lecturer in class? You've got to be thinking critically. You can't just accept these things. So that was the one part of our response to that. And the other part of our response was then we've added a button into this that the student can actually, if they see a response they can send us a message and then say to us, I got this response. It doesn't really tie up with what you said in class. Just have a look for me. So there's sort of then, after all of these things happened, the dashboard that we developed for this. So I can see my students, I can see when they were last online, and I can see their chats and go into it. And the student can then flag and send me an email if they are concerned, and straight out of the app, so there's no friction involved there. So again, I'm really not trying to promote this. We've been experiencing challenges with this large language model with ChatGPT, and this is just the way we've overcome them every time. It's not necessarily the best way, the right way. I mean, it's early days in all of this that we're facing, but it's just the way we've tried to think to respond. And it would be awesome to hear from you if you've got any suggestions on how alternative ways you've been responding to any of these challenges. I was doing a call not so long ago with some colleagues in South Africa, and they also said to us, you know what, this finding going one by one student is really, it's impossible. We have too big a classrooms. Even the students sending us the message, that's great. Is there not a way we can get something better? And we thought about it for a while, and we thought, no, we've also thought that. So eventually what we realized is, you know, we should start embracing this for what it is. So we've managed now to send a prompt through to ChatGPT. We have the students' conversations. We send them through to the language model, the GPT model, and we send a prompt through asking it for an analysis of our students' conversations with it the past week, not identifying our students. We don't really know, we're not worried in this case now who the individual is. We want to know, where is our class? Are there things that a lot of them are asking? Are there things that a lot of them are battling with? Is there particular topics that came up more than others? So give me a diagnostic report. And that's really, from my side as a teacher, been the real value of this, is giving me something that I can then take back to class tomorrow and I can action it in class. So getting towards the end of my presentation here now, the big topic is assessment. And I don't think we need to fear it. I think we need to, as Homer's hiding in the bush, I don't think we should be hiding away from it. There's a lot of work going on this. I know Cradle, if you want to Google Cradle in Australia, a special shout out to the work they're doing on assessment of ChatGPT. Here's an example of what we've done in one of our sit-in tests during the year. We gave them a question to ChatGPT. We gave them the response, and we said to them, discuss that response. And then they had to go away and now decide, was that right? Was this wrong? What else should they discuss? So, yeah, we need to be taking more control of this. We shouldn't be fearing it. We should be embracing it. I think it can only make our teaching and learning better over time. So, yes, I think we're stronger together, and I look forward to what everybody has to share afterwards and any questions you might have.
Well, Stephen, thank you so much. This has been absolutely fascinating to see what you've achieved in a really short period of time, is just incredible. So, you know, we'd love to see where this is in a year's time and in 2 years' time. Thanks, Stephen. Thank you so much.